the Joan Quinn Profiles. As an editor for Andy Warhol's Interview, the Los Angeles Herald Examiner, LA Style, and Detour magazines, Joan covered the social set, the Hollywood hotshots, the international art scene, the mysteries of food, the excitement of travel, and the fabulous world of fashion. Joan continues to find creative people on the cutting edge who make things happen. Here's Joan Agajanian Quinn.
Hi, I'm Joan Quinn, and welcome to the Joan Quinn Profiles. Waiting to be profiled is director Tamra Davis and artist Simone Gad. When I first met Tamra, she was into music, loud, loud music, with lots of young musicians hanging around. She had a video cam and she was shooting everything that went on, and I thought, oh, this must just be for fun. But no, it wasn't for fun. I think it was just the beginning of going on to direct 30 music videos, 30 plus. Then we met again when we were both interviewing the late painter Jean-Michel Basquiat. She was in the midst of completing a documentary, and I think she still is in the midst of completing it. In 1993, boom. I think Tamra went ballistics. She made an independent film called Gun Crazy, and she got a Best Actress Award from the Golden Globes. I think Drew Barrymore. Oh, a nomination. Uh-huh. And then she had her first feature film also, CB40.
CB4.
I should know that. Thanks, CB4, for Universal and Imagine.
Right.
Were you an overnight success?
No, I don't think so. I don't know. I guess very few directors are probably overnight successes.
I think everyone was writing about you at the time and saying, this is Tamra, this is her first film. You had made Gun Crazy, which was pretty gutsy. How much was your budget?
It was really low budget. We made it for under $1 million, right about $800,000, and we had 23 days to shoot it, which was, you know, really tight schedule. And I think maybe if you, what happened was, is Gun Crazy, when I finished it, I went right into doing CB4. We basically had only 5 or 6 weeks of preparation. And so it was quite interesting that both of them came out pretty much, you know, only a month apart theatrically. So it seemed like, you know, all of a sudden I just started making movies.
Exactly, so that's why you were this overnight success, not knowing what I had seen, carrying your cameras and everything, and making all those videos. Was it different making a film and being successful in the film realm rather than being a success on MTV?
Yeah, I mean, I'd always wanted to make features, and, you know, when I went to film school, that was my goal, was to become a feature filmmaker. But at that time, I was, you know, it was earlier on in Hollywood, and I was just 23, and I guess there have been very few young women that have come into Hollywood and made, like, you know, really good big features, and so they weren't, like, waiting for the next woman to walk through their door to you know, look for that same opportunity. So I was immediately open to the whole music video world, which didn't care if you were a woman, whatever you were,
or age,
anything like that. And so I was able to work, and the videos that I made bands for became successful, and it was really fun. And I love music so much that it was really cool to, you know, hang out with the musicians and the music that you really like, and that was really, really fun.
But did the music videos really help you do Gun Crazy?
They do. I mean, in a sense, what you learn as a director is you learn, first of all, you have the same size crews usually, so you can have 40 to 60 people on your crew. And so, you know, and you really kind of figure out what you can do in a day. And a movie is just you know, 6 days a week usually of all those, you know, things. And so, I mean, I think I learned really well how to, you know, be an authoritative figure on a set and how to work with people and how to get a performance out of somebody that may not be used to performing in front of a camera, and, you know, make sure that feels real. And if, and also you learn, like, if something's not going good, to say cut and do it again, you know, not just like, oh, okay, and not speak up, but really to, you know, follow the project through and, you know, make sure it's always good.
How did the funding and the backing come? Was that also on, say, the foundation of your music videos, or did you have to do it mostly?
In music videos, the record companies pay for the videos and, you know, somehow the record companies and the bands. But in films, I mean, I would have meetings, like 2, 3, 4 meetings a week on all different kinds of films. I would go out to lunch with almost anybody that would say, like, hey, I have a movie, you know, are you interested?
Oh, so you were going to help, were going to work on someone else's movie?
Well, Gun Crazy, I didn't write myself, and neither, I didn't write CB4 either, so I'm kind of more of a director for hire, so I'll go and I'll like a project and I'll meet with people, and you kind of never know, you know, if it's for real or where the money's coming from. But, you know, hopefully I was lucky that Gun Crazy really came together privately financed, and then a company came in with overseas money. And, you know, so it was still really low, but, you know, we had enough to make the movie, so that was good.
And you were in production with that, I guess, when CB4 came about. Did that help you? The Gun Crazy help you?
Yeah, they kind of looked at Gun Crazy hadn't been released yet, and I was, when it was released, it was so exciting because of all the critical acclaim that came with it. I was just completely blown away by what critics can do to support you as a young filmmaker. It was wonderful. But when I did CB4, I had just finished Gun Crazy, so nobody had really seen it yet, and they just and it was such a different movie that they could only really look at it and see that I could tell a story, which is really important for music video directors or for anybody, you know, who's making films, is to make something that at least makes sense and tells a story.
But you tell a story in a music video in just a few seconds or a minute or two minutes, right? And then this gives you 90 minutes or whatever.
Yeah, you have to make a point. You know, you have to make something a longer time.
In between.
Yeah. And a lot of music video directors get so hung up on the whole stylized thing of it and the images. And when you're making films, if you just have a movie that's filled with style, it doesn't mean anything. It can be gorgeous looking, but you'll get torn apart, you know, and people won't care, you know. So it really comes down to the actors and the story, and which I felt really confident about with the script and the actors I had for Gun Crazy.
So let's see a clip from that, and then you can tell me how you got the actors and et cetera.
Okay, cool.
Do we have to set it up in any way?
Not really. This is it's a scene with Drew Barrymore, and she's just met this boyfriend of hers, James LeGros, and they've gone out for a night of test shooting.
Okay, we'll see that.
Okay.
Oh, jeez! Tell me this thing was loaded.
I've got plenty of bullets.
Well, you can't shoot out here.
Sure you can. No one can hear us all the way out here. Go for it.
Come on, if you say so.
Good.
Yeah. You gonna try? Oh my God. That's not bad. Well, you got a future if you start going to mass murder business.
Well, I don't think I'll be doing that.
Oh, my God. Anita, put your top on. Jesus.
What's wrong?
Cover yourself up. Don't.
To make you happy.
Yeah, I know, well, that's just not any way to do it.
That was really great. How did you do the casting?
Let's see. Well, Drew had come into the office, and it was interesting with her. People had suggested her in the past, you know, for this, and I hadn't seen her work recently because this was at a time where she hadn't, you know, come back into the public eye. And she called me up and read the script and said, you have to see me. I am this character. And she came in, and anybody that meets Drew Barrymore in person, you are completely blown away. She's so beautiful, and she has so much life and, like, a thing about her where you fall in love with her the moment you see her. So I was like, oh, my God. Of course, I, you know, would love to work with her.
But do you say that to people must call you all the time. Do you say, yes, come in?
Not always. You just have a feeling? Yeah, sometimes you have a feeling. And I was also happy with James LeGros, who's an incredible, incredible actor. And he I had seen in Drugstore Cowboy and just for some reason felt like he was the character. And he even came in red, and I didn't even notice him when he came in red on the audition. He didn't look the same. He was really quiet in person. And yet, and so I didn't even notice when he read and he had left. And weeks later, I was like, bring me that guy from Drugstore Cowboy. And they're like, you already saw him. And I talked to him on the phone, and you know, we kind of made the deal over the phone, basically.
Just because you had that feeling.
Yeah, I just felt like he had it in him to do this character.
Would you say this was your big break in filmmaking?
I guess so. I mean, for, gosh, I don't, 6 years I tried to get somebody to, you know, believe me that I could make a film. And so, you know, finally when I was able to make my first feature, I felt like, oh, great. I did it and I felt really good about it. But, I mean, to me, anytime you're working, I feel like it's a big break, you know, because it's such a competitive.
One thing you do a lot of is, I say, the dreaded D, because documentary people say it's so hard. They call it the big D, but mm-hmm. we can't talk about documentaries. You've made a lot of documentaries. You've made short films.
I love that. I mean,
You're not afraid of documentary label.
I think documentaries are really cool. If I'm watching television, that's what I prefer to watch. There's like a really good documentary. And as a filmmaker, I just recently did a short film where it was so easy. I could go out myself with a camera and a sound man and go make something that I really believed in and I felt something about. And you know, you learn. It's an educational thing.
You still like to take the camera out?
I do.
I do. I love it. This is like the first time I saw you. But you mentioned film school.
Uh-huh.
You went 3 years to Los Angeles City College.
Right,
I mean,
yeah.
With all these people in the business who are so high-powered and go to all these high-powered schools, was that enough training for you?
Yeah, I mean, at LACC, it's what I found that I really respected from the school was when you make a film, you show it to an audience. And at LACC, it's people who are sitting in the audience. It isn't just like pretentious film students that come from rich backgrounds and things like that. You have multi, you know, racial backgrounds and young people and even old people. And I felt like these are the people I'm making films for. I'm not making films only for critics and for other film students. I'm making them for people and the masses. And I learned a lot from that. I felt it was really,
Doesn't hamper you that it was LACC. They
no,
don't look
who
down.
Who cares? You know what I mean? I didn't even graduate high school. It's not about what your education is that much in film. You know, it's like being an artist. It doesn't matter. You just have to be
your vision.
Yeah, your vision has to be clear, and you have to believe in yourself and be, you know, strong about it.
From City College, you went on to be able to intern with Coppola or assist,
yeah.
Or what'd you do?
Well, I was kind of tricky. He was doing this high school assistance program on One from the Heart, and I snuck in because I knew the producers. And I was able to sit and watch him direct that movie, which was just so fascinating to watch because it was right on the verge of you know, bringing in video and film, and technically it was really ahead of its time. So it was great to watch him and watch, you know, him making films.
So it was just during that one period?
Well,
that
during
you worked
One from
him?
The Heart, yeah. Yeah, and mostly I just watched him work. You know, I didn't really, it was kind of nice to be a girl that you could just sit in the corner and nobody really cared. They're like, oh, there's just some girl sitting there. Let's not pay any attention to her.
That's great. Well,
Yeah. Today
we paid attention to you, and all of our viewers paid attention to you, too. And thank you for being with us. I know you have some more productions that you're working on right now, and I think everyone's going to look for Tamra, T-A-M-R-A. Right?
Yes. Thank you so much, Joan. It was nice seeing you again.
Good, and nice to have you with us. Don't go away, because we'll be right back with artist Simone Gad. I'm Joan Quinn, and I'm back with artist-actress Simone Gad. Simone leads a double life. As an artist, she's had shows in European galleries and galleries across the United States. As an actress, you've seen her in commercials, guesting on television shows, and working in Equity Theater. But she lights up the screen with this quirky kind of way that she has in feature films, too. She moved with her parents from Brussels, Belgium, where she was born, to the United States in 1954. And oddly, there's that word again, enough. Simone, you seem to be stuck in the 50s. Did that have anything to do with moving here?
I suppose so.
Are you in a time warp?
Yes, I've been told that I'm in a time warp, so I guess that's what's happening. I came here to East L.A. I grew up in East L.A. and started with the acting career then. And
From Brussels?
Yes, right from Brussels. First we landed in New York and then took the train to Los Angeles, and a lot of refugees were living in East L.A. So that's where we ended up being, and I started right in with the acting right then.
Did you go to school there too?
Not in Europe. I went
to
school here, yes. Sheridan Street School, and then I moved to the West Side, and then I went to Fairfax High School.
So you started acting first, before you became an artist.
Oh, definitely.
And you must have been very young at that time.
Yes.
I mean, how did you get into acting coming over from Belgium?
Well, my mother wanted me to be an actress. You know, she was like the typical stage mother.
She really was?
She really was. So it was pretty weird. And then she dragged me to auditions, and I started out studying at Meglin Studios, which was a...
Oh, you're kidding!
No.
Those little Meglin babies,
yes,
they called them?
I was one of the little Meglin kitties.
And did you tap dance and sing? And
yes, the whole thing. And USO shows, it was interesting.
So you actually did have time on stage, and you
Definitely.
So then, when you were here, were you feeling more Belgique or more American?
I was torn.
Yeah, when I think.
Oh, definitely. I first started out only speaking French, and then in nursery school, everybody else spoke English. So I felt really strange, and I started not speaking French and babbling and trying to learn English, and then finally I picked it up, and then I forgot my French. So by that time, it was kind of too late, or so I thought. Then I wanted to be a Belgique again.
Did the French come back to you, or can you speak it now?
Yes, I speak it now. I go back and visit my family back there, and I exhibit my work in Europe, so I get the opportunity to practice.
I think you said you spoke German as well.
Yes, I speak some German.
And you've had shows in Dusseldorf, I know. And you're planning to do more in Germany?
Yes, I'm represented by a gallery in Dusseldorf, Ude Gallery.
But do you act in Europe?
No, I haven't been really acting in Europe. I've been acting in New York and out here and in the Midwest also. I'd like to work in Europe as an actress.
How did all this dual career take place? You started as a child actress. Mm-hmm. Then when, I know you went to Art Center, you said.
Right.
How did the art part of it come in?
I majored in art all through school, and then I went through this thing where I thought, well, I can't be an actress and an artist. I can't be an artist and an actress. And it got to be really confusing. So I had some kind of weird experiences growing up here with the entertainment industry that I couldn't deal with at the time. So I switched to contemporary art. And then I did performance pieces, and then I realized that I really missed acting. So I went back to it in the mid-80s.
And so the performance pieces really were a combination of your artwork,
right,
and
acting.
And your acting, because your artwork is collage,
right,
anyway, isn't it?
Uh-huh.
Tell us a little bit about it. How do you find the subject matter and the pieces that go together?
Well, I use Hollywood images. This one is Judy Garland, and it's from the film Wizard of Oz. It has objects collaged and glued onto the surface, and then it's painted with acrylic.
Where did the objects come from?
I do a lot of thrift shopping and going to swap meets, and when I travel, I go to souvenir shops and junk stores.
So it's all recycled?
Definitely
work.
Recycled.
You need recycled. Do you use anything new ever in your work?
Occasionally, but I like recycled ready-made objects.
So the Hollywood, part of this Hollywood really goes in with your acting, your background,
most
that
definitely,
part of it.
Most definitely, yes.
And then the other one we
have. Oh, these are self-portrait pieces. So I did a series of self-portraits, and I did a show at Troy Gallery in downtown in Little Tokyo, and that's a series of self-portraits that I have.
Are they photographs of you?
Yeah, they're my acting pictures that I made into art pieces.
Oh, I see. And then where do you, the same thing, does the memorabilia that you have on the canvas mean anything specifically?
Yes.
Oh, it does? Oh, tell us about this one then.
Well, this one, I went to Cologne and I did a show in Dusseldorf. It was my first solo show in Europe. And it was in 1990, so I went shopping to different thrift stores and souvenir shops, and this particular one I got by the Dome in Cologne. So
this is really a German self-portrait.
It's a German and Belgique self-portrait because I also went to the Vieux Marché, which is Old World Market in Brussels, and bought this particular object.
So it all means something.
Yes.
When you're making a movie or you're making a commercial, do people ask you to do their portraits?
Sometimes they do.
That's happened in the...
Yeah. Yeah, I did a commission piece for this director that I worked with, and Madonna bought a couple of pieces
did
of
she?
My work. Yeah.
I know one thing you talked about being in New York, you used to do the windows at Victoria Falls mm-hmm. before it closed. It was a dress shop or a recycling shop, or what was it, basically?
It was a combination of dress shop and alternative space. A lot of artists did their windows.
Oh, but it was in Soho.
Right.
And so that just took you back to that kind of art installation, theater kind of thing?
Uh-huh. And that's when I started combining performance works with installations.
What have you done in the theater?
I've done a lot of let's see, I did a performance at the LA Theater Center, and it was a stand-up comedy piece, and it was a variety show.
But your own, just you alone.
Yes.
Do you work on other theater productions? In them?
Yes, in them. Actually, that one was a variety show, and I had this one-act performance within that show.
I see.
And I've done a lot of one-act plays. I did a film, a feature called Speed, starring Keanu Reeves and Dennis Hopper, and that was a fun film.
That's great. I want to talk about your film work. I also want to talk about your commercial work, because you've when they talk about a reel filled with commercials, you've done commercials that have gone all over the world. We have a couple of them that we're going to show now, because I think it really shows your personality.
Oh, great.
Going over to other people's houses for the holidays. So it'd be really nice to have them at a house of my own. You know, people saying holiday things like, oh, what a lovely home you have, or, hey, Melissa, great wreath on your door.
Play Kentucky Lottery's Home for the Holidays. Win up to $20,000 instantly, or 4 losing tickets could win you the house of your dreams.
And the best part would be, you know, throwing all the coats in a big pile in the bedroom and then getting them all back later.
Last year, Twin Value sold enough clothes to provide everyone in Cuyahoga Falls with a new outfit. Well, if that happens here, I'd like a scoop neck jumpsuit. Oh yeah, and red makes me look chunky. Thank you.
Twin Value has come to Euclid with the lowest prices on all the latest spring fashions. Twin Value, you've never seen low prices like this because you've never seen a store like this.
Those are so funny. Do you dress just like you're dressed now when you go to audition for those commercials?
Actually, I do.
I mean, they're so cute.
Oh, thank you.
So do you know what they're looking for so that when you go in, you have a certain idea of what to do?
Yes. I mean, my agent or my manager calls me and prepares me, you know, gives me an idea of what they're looking for. And it's usually pretty strong character stuff. So I mostly wear vintage clothing, and sometimes I'll go out for something more conservative as far as the dress goes, so I do have that, but mostly it's pretty offbeat stuff.
Did you do stand-up comedy so that you're able to get into these things?
Yeah, I took a stand-up comedy class with Judy Carter, and I did a lot of performances, and it was really fun.
Yeah, we have another clip that I want to show, because it shows the comedic background, or that kind of thing that you have, and it's called The New Munsters Today.
Oh, that's right.
Is that right?
Yeah.
So, well, let's look at that, and then you see how you get your face slammed in, and you never get pushed out of the way. You won't take no for an answer. This is Simone, and what's it called? Munsters Today.
Yeah.
I fast for watching a football game.
Hi, Mr. Munster. I have a little surprise for you.
Great, thanks.
Lily said I could drop it by any time. I hope it's not an inconvenience.
No problem. Thanks. Bye.
Well, everything you need is inside the basket. I'll be back around dinner time. Bye now. I can't thank you enough.
You can. You have. Goodbye.
Wait, you forgot to return his basket. Like I said, just one last little thing. Don't you want to let me have his dirty diapers?
Those are so funny.
Oh, thanks.
What if you had your own series? What kind of character would you want to play?
Well, that's a good question. well, something that has some meat to it, you know. Something that has some, comic elements, but some dramatic elements to it. That has political intrigue or not just that, but something that is not just sitcom-y, but that has more of some meaning behind it.
You couldn't see yourself as like the nanny or some kind of character like that? Or the Golden Girls or something?
Oh, yeah,
like
the Golden Girls or Picket Fences or I like Dave's World and I like Masterpiece Theater.
Oh, with that, I think we're going to have to leave. Very quickly, do you think you could choose one career, artist or actress?
No, I like them both.
So you think your whole career is?
Both.
Both. Okay. Well, we're going to watch you for both. Thanks for being
with us,
Simone Gad. And thank you all for watching us today. And we'll see you next time on the Joan Quinn Profiles.